Steven Roy Goodman, host of Higher Education Today. Welcome back to the education program that connects you to contemporary issues, people, and institutions involved in the world of higher education. Today's show is a special show about art history. I'm here with Nick Ross, who's the director of Art History Abroad. Nick is the author of two books about art history and a guide to art in Florence. Welcome, Nick.
Hello. Nice to see you.
Well, great to see you. Thanks for coming in, and welcome back to the United States.
Thank you.
Well, Nick, if you could say a word or two about what is Art History Abroad, and give us an introduction to what it is that you run.
Okay. Art History Abroad is sort of a unique type of a school. We essentially take students from all over the world to Italy to teach them history of art. And that's all we do. So we're specialists and experts in that. And the key to what we do is that we feel that if you're going to be studying art, the absolutely important thing to do is to go and see the real thing for itself. Now, there's more significant art in Italy, perhaps, arguably, than almost anywhere else in the world. And also Venice and Florence and Rome and Naples and Siena, as individual city-states until 1860, are completely diverse cities. And it means that they each have their own artistic and architectural traditions. So if you go and study on site and study paintings and fresco cycles that are still in the churches and the buildings for which they were originally designed, then you get the context and the history of art, and it becomes a proper art history.
Well, that's interesting, but why wouldn't I do that through my high school or my university?
One could, and that's completely valid. But I suppose the key difference is to be able to go and see these things for oneself. And for us, we think that if you're going to be studying these things, it ought to be one on site, but secondly in a small tutorial group. So all of our seminars are no more than eight, and a young and engaging expert with them. And the key is that everybody can see and properly see, and we'll come on to this later, but also to join in discussions, because art and culture is very much about discussion.
Well, and speaking of discussion, so a lot of people argue that art is kind of for the elite and not for the masses. And how do we bring discussions about art history to the broader public?
Okay, the point about art being for the masses, it just strikes me that if you look at any artistic movement, any movement in style or fashion, it always comes from the bottom up. It doesn't come from the top down. And yes, I do agree that these things are expensive and that tends to put them outside a lot of people's reach. But at the same time, I think in Britain it would be true to say that there's more spent on art and culture than there is on football. And so there is a massive input from the government to see that everybody has a chance to experience these things. And the wonderful thing I have to say about America is that I'm constantly surprised at how many great institutions, private and public, there are throughout the country, and the amazing programs that there are of engagement and involvement for everybody. So, for example, I was at the Dallas Museum of Art last week, where I was asked to give a lecture for a teen program that was well-timed. It was done in the evening, it wasn't done during the day. There's a special trust fund set up to enable people who wouldn't ordinarily be able to come in and afford the fare to come in and see the exhibitions and attend the program. So everything's paid for and people are encouraged to come in. And I was amazed because, frankly, it was a fairly esoteric exhibition. It's about Middle Ages art and artifacts from the Cluny Museum in Paris. And people came in, there were 25 people attending of all sorts, and it was wonderful and quite a wide range of teenager. And it was an amazing program run by that museum, and it's well funded and orientated to the people who wouldn't ordinarily be able to afford it or necessarily be interested in it. It's brilliant.
Well, interesting. So let's assume I was a student in Dallas, a high school student in Dallas. What would you encourage me to study as a high school student to get ready to prepare to appreciate the art that I would have seen at that exhibit?
In one respect, I would start fishing around for films. It's a good and easy way to get involved in these things. And so often film sets are pretty well observed. In fact, you know, it's one of the places that art historians end up is in set design. And so quite often these are well observed. And there are loads of, even if it's Game of Thrones, I'm sorry to be flippant, but it's a way of getting involved in medievalism, if you like, and understanding some of the levers of power. And that's essentially what it is, and the influence of the church and so on. So to start with, take an interest in what's on film. But then in terms of reading, it's quite esoteric, but certainly going to churches. In Dallas, for example, I went to the Methodist Church. Fantastic, you know, Gothic architecture. And then I also went to the First Baptist Church. Again, a wonderful 19th century Gothic building, but it refers you back to the past.
Well, but in terms of the past, I mean, one of the things that I always think about when I think about art history is the past, the past, and the past. And how do we bring that to today? Because a lot of people say, well, I don't necessarily want to study art history. I'd rather study something that I could focus on, which focuses on the future.
It's a good question, but in much the same way that any writer, if you ask any writer how did they start, they always said, I read a lot. It's not as if they picked up a pen for the first time and started scribbling away. They always look back, and the same is true of artists. So Jackson Pollock, the most wonderful draftsman. You wouldn't necessarily see that in his paintings that you see in the Met or whatever, but a fantastic draftsman, and he looked back. Picasso also looked back. In fact, Picasso said, I never thought up anything new. I always stole other people's ideas. So in order to go forward, I'd argue, and I think many artists would do the same, it's really important to look back and see how other people in the past have dealt with problems, dealt with, you know, issues of patronage, that somebody comes to you and says, I want this, and it's not a particularly easy thing to do. And half of the joy of these things is seeing how the artist has got out of a problem, or an architect has solved a problem. And so by engaging with that sort of thought process, not only do you appreciate what's been done and the wonder of that creativity, but also it gives you techniques to go forward.
Well, that's interesting. But how would you, what problem are you thinking about? So if I'm sorting out a problem architecturally, does that mean I have a challenge in terms of the lighting, or I have a challenge in terms of the space?
Oh yes, for sure, absolutely. Or budget, or technical problems with the building. I don't know. For example, I was talking last night to somebody about a vast painting by John Singleton Copley, who's one of America's greatest 18th century portrait paintings. He ended up in London. He did what is now the largest canvas in Britain. Lifting it to put it on the wall was an enormous problem. Which gave great difficulty to the architects of the building. It was a new build. And so not only are they talking about light and security and flow of people through the building, but then their one of their problems was, how do you lift a 2-ton painting off the floor without putting any pressure on the floor? And the way they solved it was marvelous, by suspending cranes from the ceiling. But all of these things, at all times, you in a sense, you could never be bored if you've got buildings around the place, because you look and look carefully and think through, how did, let's say, somebody in this building deal with the air conditioning and reducing the amount of light coming into the building, and therefore cutting that expense and being more ecological. And you only have to look at the facade of a building, a modern building, and you think, oh, that's quite clever. He's orientated this so that there's not too much direct sunlight. Or she's put this vast overhang on the roof that in the high summer is going to cast a deep shadow over 2/3 of the building. Those sorts of things. And it's only when you look and you think through some of the problems that you see some pretty ingenious solutions.
Well, in terms of these solutions, let's get students ready for solving some of these. So what are some courses that you recommend that a student, either on a high school level or a college level, or you might say university level, would take to prepare to help solve some of these issues?
Okay, so here in the States, the principal way in at high school is through the AP programs. And so the College Board, college level papers in art history. Now they've just changed them or updated them, and essentially it boils down to 250 works of art. And what they've done, which is quite interesting, is that they've taken not just the narrow canon of European art, which is what art history used to be, but they've expanded it. So there are now 250 items from around the world, and it's really interesting what they've chosen. And so that's one way at high school in which you can prepare yourself to go on into college. However, obviously there are lots of high schools that don't do that. They don't have the resources or whatever. And in that case, I would really urge people to work hard on their practical art, because whatever you do in the world of art, understanding technique and materials is absolutely vital, and it will bear fruit in the future. So as a first start, there's that. Then, as we've already described, the team programs offered by the museums around America are fantastic, and they're open to all. And not only do they pick up on individual exhibitions, but they also follow a program of art relying on the collection of that particular institution. So they are marvelous. There are lots of scholarships that one can engage in, and it's worth looking for those. We, for example, at Art History Abroad, run a scholarship which is based on an essay competition, which is not designed to solicit art historical information so much as a feeling about art and a response to art. So we simply ask, write 400 words on a work of art that you love, and then write 400 words on a work of art that you absolutely loathe. And it could be anything, like from a bus, you know, a piece of design, or a work of art. And what we're looking for is not facts, we're looking for a gut reaction. And so anybody can write it. And there are lots of programs like that around.
That's really interesting. So what would be an example of somebody who would loathe a piece of art, and what would they loathe about it?
Oh, this is great. There's this a winner a few years ago. She wrote about Canova's Cupid and Psyche. It's a neoclassical sculpture. It's not very big. It's in Paris. It's absolutely charming, and it tells a mythological story, which I won't go into, except for the fact that it's a very dear love story. Unlikely, also. In the Canova sculpture, he's cradling, Cupid is cradling Psyche. She loved it. She hated Tracy Emin's bed, which is a modern piece of sculpture, and it's a disheveled bed with cigarette butts and all manner of things. Essentially, Tracy Emin spent 4 or 5 days in the bed before she exhibited it. This young scholar made the comparison of love. She said, the Cupid and Psyche is one example of love, and the Tracy Emin depicts another side of love that I absolutely abhor. Now, personally, I think Tracy Emin's bed is rather a wonderful piece of self-portraiture in a way, and painfully revealing in some senses. She lays herself bare, and it's rather wonderful for that. But this young scholar said, actually, that's not what I think about in love, and this Cupid and Psyche is. And she rounded off by saying, you know, one day I kind of hope that somebody will hold me like the Canova. And at which point you think this is a completely personal interpretation of these things. And she was a very able scholar, and she's gone on to great things.
That's really interesting, because if you think about something like love, a lot of art, a lot of literature is capturing that at that moment that it's being created. But that could change over time. Yeah. The way we love, the way we think about love, the way we approach love in society generally, that can change over time.
Yeah, absolutely. Botticelli, his paintings, you know, very famous, Birth of Venus, Primavera, all of those sorts of paintings are wonderful because they describe the vicissitudes of love. And there are all sorts of reasons why that little pocket of paintings happened when it did. And that's really the joy of art history, is that you're trying to work out why things look the way they do. And it's not a simple question. And it draws on, in that case, on anthropology. At other times, it's about economic history or the nature of patronage or political history or church history and theology. Art history is the most wonderful subject for branching out into almost every other subject. It's the greatest testament, in my view, to history. You know, documents are one thing, and they are tremendous articles of history, but the trouble with the written word is that it means you are inevitably stuck with an order. You have a hierarchy of what you're saying. The great thing about art is, rather like a poem, you can say lots of things all at the same time. And that is sort of like life. That's sort of like the way we respond emotionally. We don't respond to things in a sequential way. We tend to do them in a collective way. And that's what art does.
But what if all of a sudden we're looking at something that's complicated and that a lot of things are happening at the same time, but I don't agree with the third thing or the second thing? So then my brain maybe turns off and says, well, I don't want to pay attention to that piece of art. How do you prevent me from turning off my brain and not paying attention to that piece of art?
engagement and argument. And that's why I do think that teaching about art is about discourse. And actually, I find when teaching, one of the best questions you can ask is, do you like this? And when people say, no, I absolutely loathe it, that's the most useful response, because then you really have to examine why somebody loathes something. And quite often the reason why they loathe it is the reason that it's important.
So could it perhaps remind them of something painful that happened in their own life?
Absolutely, absolutely. Or you have a particularly sort of dogmatic, dictatorial piece of art. You know, if you look at fascist architecture in Rome, lots of people don't like that. It's cold and all of those sorts of things, and monumental and so on. And somebody might not like it for that reason. You say, well, actually, that's the point. It was supposed to be monumental. Mussolini was trying to imitate Caesar Augustus. And so you get to the point of the thing through somebody's dislike. So I'm never afraid of somebody switching off. In fact, I find it rather invigorating.
But how do you switch them back on then?
Engagement, argument. Push, find out why. Why don't they like something?
Well, let's take your argument about Mussolini. So let's assume that I saw something and it reminded me of the time of Mussolini. And let's say I was Italian-American and I wanted to repress that in my own mind.
Well, ultimately, you can withdraw within your own mind and close me off. But then, from my point of view, I'd be interested to know, if you're an Italian American, perhaps the reason that you left Italy was because of that sort of repression and the sorts of opportunities that America offers, which then could lead one into a discussion of the 1930s and the rise of fascism and why those things happened, and why fascism grew in these poorer countries like Germany and Italy. So it's an opportunity to turn things into a broader discussion.
And speaking of that broader discussion, let's assume we were having this discussion in Florence or in Rome or in Siena. Would we be approaching the history of art differently than we would in Washington, D.C.?
Yeah, I think so, only because the context is right there. So if I'm talking about something old, like a Franciscan church, one can look around the area where that church is and ask people, quite simply, what do you think of the buildings here? And the point is that Franciscan churches were generally in the poor part of town because of St. Francis' devotion to the poor and the needy. Whereas Dominican churches, which are all about education and establishment, tend to be in the richer parts of town. And so in Florence, the Dominican church is by the richest shopping street in Florence, whereas the Franciscan church is down by all the butchers and the markets. And so immediately one can ask people to look and observe where they are and their surroundings, and that has an effect on the art, or that has an implication for the art and the architecture around one. So the difference would be context.
And in terms of the context, the students who come on your program, I assume you're giving them the context, a hands-on context, day to day.
Yeah, all the time. We're teaching for about seven hours a day, and we're always on site. And I think it's enormously important that, you know, if you're looking at a Palladian church and part of the point is that it's about proportion and mathematics, well, pace out the mathematics, measure it, work it out, actually work out whether what you've read in the book is actually what you find in the building. And it's not unusual that I find that people who've been writing haven't necessarily physically approached the building or the work of art. I think it's really important that if you're looking at a work of art for the first time, that you view it as a physical object, you don't see it as an image. So I don't know what you do when you first look at a painting, what do you do when you first look at a painting?
Well, if I can ask you the question, what's the difference between a physical piece of art and an image?
Okay, so for example, and I learned this from my wife who restores old master pictures, So, for example, if I'm looking at a picture, the first thing I do is check to see whether it's all there. Because more often than not, or quite often, you'll find that the picture's been cut down. Now, if it's been cut down, you might be missing something that's pertinent or relevant. You can tell that partly by whether the frame is the original frame or not, or whether some element of the composition runs off the edge of the frame. That's the first thing. The second thing to do is to look at the surface, see if there are any blemishes. Quite often on church paintings, you'll see where the candles were too close to the image and it's burnt the paint. And so immediately, if you're looking at something that's in a museum, you can then, not only on the basis of the subject matter, but by the condition of the painting, make some assumptions. Whether it's cracked. If it's cracked, then it's on a piece of wood. If it's on wood, then it's a panel painting, and that has implications as to what it's painted with, as opposed to being on canvas, where it has to be painted with oil paint. All of these things, by just looking at the physicality of the thing, then you can make assumptions about what it's made of, and therefore why and how and when. But most importantly, as you're looking at it as a physical object, you're looking all over the image, as opposed to being controlled by the artist. Because after all, the job of an artist is to control your eye as the viewer. So if you approach it and allow the artist to guide you through their painting, then you're not analyzing it objectively. But by looking at it as a physical object and making assumptions that way, you really look at the thing and you notice all sorts of other elements and details, which then give you a much better interpretation of the painting.
That's a very fair point, but when I go to a museum, I'm letting myself go to the museum. I decided I'm going to take the morning off and go to the museum, so I'm ready for the input.
Yes, but you also have to output. Going to a museum is exhausting, and I don't know if you ever suffer from museum fatigue when you've been in there for an hour and you're thinking to yourself, I'm really exhausted now. And you can see that with children going around. And teenagers, well, anybody, to be honest, you can see when they're just gently switching off. And the reason it happens is that, or the disappointing thing about it is that you know that going around a museum is supposed to be good for you, and at the same time you're feeling really awful and tired, and it's the fatigue that you get. Now, the only reason you get fatigue is that you're taking in a vast amount of information, and the best thing to do is, if you know, not just to let it flow over you, but to interrogate it. And the more questions you ask, the more you'll get out of things. And it's as I was describing with buildings, you know, you observe things carefully, try and work out why is that like that, and how does that stand up, or why is this in this composition, has he got a bright light in the back of the picture over there, you know, so to tease out why things look the way they do.
But you know, that's interesting, but I'm thinking as you're saying that about literature. Yeah. And so, but when I hold a book, I can put it down for a few minutes, or I can put it down for 2 days and come back to it. I could think about the idea that the author is raising. Yeah. But I may not have that luxury when I'm going to an art museum.
That's true. And I remember in Brideshead Revisited, Sebastian at one point remembers a glass of wine that he'd drunk. He remembers a vintage that he'd drunk 24 years before. And I have to say that there are pictures that I remember seeing 20 years ago that I haven't seen since. But the memory of them still lingers in the mind and the enjoyment of them. And so, yes, it's an inevitability, sadly, that there are some things that you just can't carry with you all the time, you know, physically, like a book, or refer back to it, but it just lies in the memory.
Well, Nick, that was very impassioned. Thank you very much. Thank you for your time, and thank you for coming onto the show today.
Thank you.
If you would like to reach Nick Ross or learn more about art history abroad, please visit their website at arthistoryabroad.com. If you have comments or suggestions about higher education today, please send an email to our viewer mailbox at highereducationtoday@topcolleges.com. Thank you for watching. We will continue to bring you quality discussions about important matters in today's college and university world. Please join me again for another edition of Higher Education Today. I'm Steven Roy Goodman, and you've been watching Higher Education Today.